Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with our hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gully and Ted Madden.
Welcome to episode 30 of the Let's Talk podcast. Of all of our guests, today's has a cultural and religious background that none of the others have, so we're looking forward to learning more from her. We will have our Lessons with LaDonna segment later in the podcast, but let's get started with introductions. I'm Ted Madden. I create videos for the school district, and I'm a 48-year-old white man.
I'm LaDonna Gully, actually Dr. LaDonna Gully. I'm the Director of Leadership and Empowerment for our wonderful district, and I am a 51-year-old African-American woman.
I am Aziza Basha. I am a third-grade teacher over at Cannaday Elementary School, and I am a 36-year-old Arab Muslim woman.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
Give us the background. Where are you from, and how did you get here?
So I am originally from Palestine. My parents immigrated from Palestine, and I immigrated when I was 5 years old. So I've been in Texas all my life, grew up here, and loving it.
And school's here, too?
School's here, too. I went through the Mesquite ISD program, started off at Cannaday in 1989, and went through Kimbrough Middle School and graduated from Poteet High School, class of 03.
Wonderful. All right.
Before we started the podcast, we were talking in my office about you decided to wait to go back to teaching to have the family first, have the kids first.
Yes. So I wanted to just experience, you know, just being a mom and not stressing about leaving my kids home and having to deal with that guilt. And I'm so glad I did. Just watching them grow up is priceless. I mean, and I respect to all those women and moms who can do both at the same time. I couldn't pull myself away. I'm like, ugh. But I'm so happy I did that because I'm dedicated to my career a lot more, knowing that my babies are somewhat grown, a little more independent than they would have been when they were younger, and I can put that dedication and focus into my career. So I'm happy I did that.
That is great. And so I would tell you that, of course, unlike so many of us, you are wearing a hijab. And so why don't you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yes. So the hijab is a big part of my identity. I wear it proudly, and I have been since fourth grade. So the hijab is a requirement that all Muslim women, girls, once they reach the age of puberty, are required to wear a hijab. And it's just a form of protection to, you know, protect your beauty and sacrificing your beauty for a higher reason. Mm-hmm. And so we sacrifice and dedicate that to our belief, you know, that we are giving something up and protecting what's sacred to us with the hijab. So it has a lot of meaning behind it, but I just love it. It protects me.
It has a lot of meaning, and it probably comes with a lot of looks.
Absolutely.
So I'm just curious, as one of the very few Muslim women in our school district in Mesquite, mm-hmm. what is that like walking through a day?
So, I mean, in all honesty, the hijab has come a long way. So we see it more and more now. Mm-hmm. When I first wore it, I was the only one wearing it all through school. So I even had Muslim peers and students who did not wear it. And so I graduated high school being the only one who was a hijabi, and it was hard. It was very hard. So you would get looks from your peers. You would definitely deal with the mean looks, and they didn't ever fail to keep their words to themselves. Sometimes they would call out some horrible names, very ugly names that you would go home and cry about. And so it was so hard. And fast forward, here we are now. My daughter is an eighth grader who is wearing the hijab, hasn't heard any of the words that I've ever heard told to me. And I feel like it's because as a society, we are more diverse. You see hijabi girls in books. Mm-hmm. We talk about it in school. We celebrate our differences and we embrace them. And I truly believe that is what has caused this change.
Yeah. In fact, I see you have one of my favorite books, and I really would like you to share those titles and those authors, because absolutely beautiful. One of those I actually gave to one of my students last year. I purchased it, and she saw it on my desk. She walked in, her eyes just got so big, because she is growing towards, and she will be wearing a hijab as well. And so I knew that. Read the book, is absolutely beautiful.
Yes.
About just the level of proud how proud you feel, and your level of confidence in wearing a hijabi and what it means. So
yes,
I think she's really excited about becoming a hijabi. I love that. And please share.
So I am so happy. I'm a reading teacher, so I love to talk to my own students through literature. And so two of my favorite books are The Proudest Blue by Ibtihaj Muhammad. So she's an Olympic medalist. Mm-hmm. And Under My Hijab by Hina Khan. And these two books do such a wonderful job of portraying the hijab in all of its beauty. And so when we think of the hijab, unfortunately, the first thing that comes to mind is she okay? You know, Is she being forced to wear that? Is she, you know, that's, and it's normal. It's normal for others to think that, because who wouldn't want to show off their hair and their beauty? But whenever you get to hear the perspective of a person wearing hijab, especially like in The Proudest Blue, this is being told from the perspective of her little sister. Mm-hmm. So Ibtihaj is actually the sister, the little sister, and she's watching her sister Aisha, who wore the hijab, and she's so proud of her older sister. And she says, I see the looks and I hear them talking about my sister's hijab. I don't know what they're talking about. And this is an actual quote. She says, Asya's hijab is like the ocean in the sky, no line between them, saying hello and with a loud wave. And so this little girl, Ibtihaj, is looking at her older sister and saying, she's so gorgeous, she's so beautiful and proud, but why is she looking sad right now? And so just listening in to that perspective, it's all about perspective. How is Ibtihaj's perspective versus Aisha's? She's the one facing the looks. She's the one getting those looks or hearing the words. Mm-hmm. And it's not always negative. Some are negative. Some are just curious. What is it? Why are you wearing it? Why do you have that thing on your head? Mm-hmm. And so that was a conversation that I would have with lots of peers. And it's about how you give the conversation. So they respect it once you let them know what it is all about, how you feel about it. And so I think that it's kind of like both sides that we need to work with, is the person asking and then, of course, the person explaining or sharing. We have to be open about it and share it proudly. And that's what Ibtihaj does in her book, The Proudest Blue, and in Under My Hijab. So, yes, I love it. love my books.
I think, as you kind of just explained there, you yourself are a teaching opportunity for your kids.
Yes.
Can you talk about at the beginning of the year, the conversations you have?
So it's adorable. I have that. If I could sum it all up, it's adorable. I teach third grade. And so my babies come into the school year, and this is my second year teaching. So it's interesting that I've had the same experience both years. The first thing I do is on day one is I read Under My Hijab. And I sit down and I get my kiddos around me and I say, we're going to address the elephant in the room. Because nobody asks, nobody wonders. They're just kind of looking at you like, she's a little different than my teacher last year, but she talks like I do. She walks like I do. So I take out my book, Under My Hijab, and the relief, the look on their faces once they do see that I am addressing it mm-hmm. on day one. So they're not building up that curiosity. Am I going to be rude if I ask Miss Basha, what is that thing on your head? So my first conversation is, it is called a hijab. You cannot get upset with someone when they call it a thing. And that's what I tell other hijabi women. They don't know what it's called. Mm-hmm. And so, like I said, it's both sides. We mm-hmm. both have to be open. This is called a hijab. Now, if you choose to call it a thing afterwards, you know what I'm saying? You know the name of it now. Mm-hmm. And so Under My Hijab does a wonderful job explaining who I am. I am still your teacher. You know, I go home just like you do. I spend time with my family just like you do. The only difference is I'm wearing a hijab, and that's a part of my wardrobe, a part of who I am. Mm-hmm. And that's really all they need to know. I don't share the religious aspect of it with my kiddos. They're way too young, and I'm a firm believer in the developmental process that kiddos go through. And so their brains, it's first of all, it's not my job to even tell that to an 8-year-old or a 9-year-old. That's their parents' wishes, and I respect that 100%. And so I just let them know it is a part of my wardrobe, and this is how I dress, and that's what the book helps me do too, because it doesn't touch on religion, and it just talks about it as a part of my identity.
Absolutely. I love that. And you talk a little bit about, I know you said that you are Muslim, but you're also Arab.
I am,
so
yes.
Talk about like the difference between the religion and the culture aspect there.
So there's often you would find a lot of confusion between culture and religion. Mm-hmm. And so being Arab does not necessarily mean you are Muslim. So Muslim is the faith that I practice, and that is why I am required to wear a hijab. And then you will meet other Arabs who could be Muslim but chose not to wear the hijab, or are Christians, or, you know, just practice a different faith. And they just so happen to have the culture of being Arab. Mm-hmm. So they're Arabs, but they're not Muslim. So a lot of times Arabs get, like, they'll associate being Arab with the hijab, and it's actually the opposite. The hijab is a part of being Muslim, not Arab. And so that's always something I love to clear up. Mm-hmm. Early on, and I'm just proud to be both, because our culture is pretty awesome. The Arab culture has a lot, we have a lot of fun things about traditions that I love to share with my kiddos, a lot of traditions that I find bring a different experience, like the way we dress, clothing. Of course, obviously, I'm not dressed anything Arab related today, but we have beautiful stitching patterns that we wear and share, and things mm-hmm. like that, dances and foods and things like that that I love to share with my kiddos, and just giving them that experience, because I love learning about other cultures. I love meeting people and tasting their food, and I'm like, why not give this experience to our kiddos early on and expose them to just different parts of the world? Mm-hmm. It's interesting, so I love having that.
I want you to talk about your parents, as we did before yes. the podcast began, because of the sacrifices they made
yes.
for their kids.
So my parents are every bit of success that I have right now is all owed to my parents and because of them. So my parents, unfortunately, did not have the opportunities that I was given. You know, back when they were younger, they did grow up in Palestine, and they were both taken out of school at an early age. So my dad didn't make it past 10th grade, and my mom didn't make it past 7th. And so whenever they made the decision to immigrate to America for better opportunities, they ended up giving us everything. And so we grew up with the mindset of, this is who you are. So let me tell you about my parents. We weren't allowed to speak English at home. And obviously they knew what they were doing, because here I am. I'm a fluent English speaker and fluent Arabic speaker, reader, and writer. Can't say the same for my kids. So what they did was hard. When I say sacrifice, I mean it. They raised us to be proud of who we are, not to forget our roots, but also never to forget where we are heading and where we are going. And so they instilled this sense of, go to school, you can do it. You can be who you are and accomplish so much. And I'm so happy I listened and I went to school. Just like, I kind of felt like I let them down when I got married and didn't continue my education. And that is why I went back to school at the age of 34. I thought to myself, I graduated with an associate's in 2005, and I can't let them down. Mm-hmm. Because they instilled this, put yourself out there, you know, change society. And you can change society by being who you are, as proud of yourself as you can possibly be, and getting others to see you for who you are and then see us for who we are. And I love that. And so I owe them everything. I love that they instilled that in me.
I love that. So you talk about the difference between you and your parents. Talk a little bit more about the difference between you and your children.
So my parents, you know, they immigrated, obviously, as young adults to the United States. So they, if you will, Palestine is their home. Mm-hmm. It is all they knew up until they immigrated to America. And then they adjusted to this life with those looks and those stares, because it was a different time. and it was harder for them, but they kept thinking, this is for my kids, this is for my kids. Well, when I was growing up, this is all I knew. I mean, I don't remember really being younger than five and living in Palestine and immigrating to America. All I remember is Cannaday and working with Miss Abernathy. She was my ESL teacher, teaching me different words. That's why I love vocabulary so much, is that is how I learned English. And I was able to overcome that obstacle, learn English, move on with my life. And I didn't know of the struggles. I just knew that it was a part of who I am to present myself as an Arab Muslim, even at the young age of 11, when I first became a hijabi, and in fourth grade. And I'd get the stares, I'd get the looks, but I had this deep-rooted passion for who I was, and I was proud of it because of my parents. So I never gave up on it, regardless of the multiple incidents that would happen, like girls picking on me, boys picking on me, a girl taking it off of my head at one point in sixth grade. And I still kept it on because I felt like a part of me didn't want to let them down, but I was also proud. Now, here we are. I have my kids of my own. I didn't go through the sacrifices my parents did. So I'm kind of wanting to change things up. I don't make my kids speak Arabic at home, and I'm regretting that now. Because in some way, it's like they lost a part of who they are. I took that away from them because, not from my daughter. My daughter is a fluent Arabic speaker. She reads and writes. I would send her to like a Sunday school where she can get some Arabic lessons. Mm-hmm. But for my two boys, a fifth grader and a kindergarten, or first grader, sorry, they don't speak Arabic and they don't read and write. And I look at it and I'm like, where did I go wrong? And is it because I ultimately did kind of go and dedicate myself to pursuing a career? Was this the price that I had to pay? Mm-hmm. It's harder to make your kids talk as easy as it may seem. It's hard to enforce, we're at home, you speak Arabic only. It was a little bit easier on my parents because that is all they knew. Right. But growing up, my siblings and I would secretly talk English to each other. And it's not they had anything against English. It's that they wanted us to be fluent in both languages and mm-hmm. become bilingual. And I'm looking and I'm like, I translate for parents. I help kiddos out because I'm bilingual. And I kind of took that opportunity from my kids. So if I could change one thing, it would be just sitting down with my parents and saying, how did you do it? So our experiences drive how we act and how we raise our own kiddos.
I know we use the dignity framework, and LaDonna talks a lot about the dignity framework. And one of those words we hear a lot is belonging. Yes. Where do you belong?
So that is a very interesting question. I feel like I belong here. Like I belong here wherever I am because I am me. I am an Arab, American, Palestinian, Muslim. Like I belong back home when I go home. I should be accepted and welcomed. I belong here because this is all I know. This is where I grew up, Mesquite, Texas. My parents still live in the same house that they did when I was in middle school. But unfortunately, we have to be honest to with ourselves at one point. And I do visit back home every now and then, and they will call me, they'll refer to me as the American. And then here I am in America, and I'm considered an immigrant or the daughter of an immigrant. And every now and then, you'll get a comment like, go back to your country. And you look and you ask yourself, okay, so I do, but they call me the American, and here I am here. This is all I've known, and yet you're telling me to go back to my country. And don't get me wrong, that's like the minority. The majority of our society is so positive, so accepting, but for those few, that is what you would get. And because of that, that sense of belonging is a little bit harder to process. You have to believe it within you. And that's where I tell you, I feel like I failed my kids because I didn't really teach them much about where we are originally from. They were born and raised here. This is all they know. And so if they would ever face that question, and there was an incident where they got to hear a man say it to me at Walmart, and they looked at me and they said, Mama, why did he say, go? But what does he mean by that? They haven't even visited back home then. Mm-hmm. And so my kids didn't even know what he meant. And a part of me went, I never told them or shared that. I just thought it'll happen one day, and I kept postponing it, and it never did. And so just educating our kids, being proud of where you're from, and teaching them that even though they haven't lived there, they have to know that this is where they are originally from. I know a lot of people are, you know, but I'm from here. You have to acknowledge at one point that you're not. And mm-hmm. so a sense of belonging starts with owning up and being proud of where you are from, and then teaching that to your kids and their kids' kids and all of that, even though this is all they know. Mm-hmm. You have to at some point have that conversation.
That's right. Other than my ancestors who I am a descendant of slaves, I think so many of us are immigrants, like right? Yes. Everyone else is an immigrant from somewhere else.
Absolutely.
I mean, no matter how many generations down, when we look at it, I think we are a land. This is a land of immigrants,
yes.
right? As
yes.
well as having indigenous peoples who are already here, you know, on this land, working this land, et cetera. And of course, slaves that were brought here. And I think that it is really important that we are sharing the importance of belonging.
Yes.
And what does that really look like, right? What does it look like to belong? And so going back to that dignity framework, which our district has adopted by Dr. Floyd Cobb and Dr. John Crownapple, that particular dignity framework is truly all about how do we create a culture of belonging, right, and inclusivity. And so we do that in a couple of ways. We do it first and foremost by really listening. And an example of that is this podcast. I think this podcast is a great example of how we listen to other people's stories and really gain a perspective that we didn't have before. The other part of that, though, is having that openness. And so you stating you have to believe it with you first, within you first. I thought that was just
yes.
very powerful because it does start with each and every one of us. That's also the empathy factor, right?
Yes.
Really putting myself in someone else's shoes.
Absolutely.
And really, and not just for a few moments, but sitting there.
Right.
And thinking about it. And then having patience.
Yes.
You know, even with people that we don't necessarily
Lots
get
of
along
patience.
With, right?
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Because oftentimes, you're right, people say things about us, they don't know us, they give us strange stares. And so I think that we all know and understand what it's like to not be included, what it feels like to not be invited to the party.
Yes.
And I think that, you know, so it's really, really worth saying. We talk, when we look at this framework, we look at it from a couple of ways. Of course, what we do with ourselves, right, and what we should be doing with others, but also organizationally, what should we be doing? And we always talk about repairing the harm and restoring the relationship. How important is that? Because you have probably faced a lot of adversity.
Yes.
And so how can others really seek out when they do harm?
So I mean, I got to look at your framework, and I absolutely love it. I feel like it's very well put together because it all ties in. So when you want to talk about the harm and repairing the harm, you have to also look at the openness side. How can someone know that they hurt you if you didn't tell them, if you didn't let them know? And so I feel like a society, we need to acknowledge the fact that there are two sides to everything. You have to be willing, like me, I have to be willing to be open about who I am. I have to be willing to not be passive and instead be assertive. Assert myself. Tell others about the hijab if they ask, even if they gave me a nasty look. And then they say, well, why do you got that thing on your head? Answer proudly and respectfully. The reason is that they don't know. You have to admit to yourself, they don't know. So put aside your hurt sometimes, if you are hurt, or put aside your anger and explain. You cannot be upset with the comments you're going to get if you didn't explain it. And so once that is established, and once you start seeing more and more of women like myself, I like to think of myself as being as assertive as I possibly can, being confident and putting myself out there, you start to understand it and comprehend it more and more. And so people become more educated. the harm will decrease. I promise you. I'm seeing it. I mean, I'm seeing it. I grew up in Mesquite. My kids are growing up in Mesquite. It's a different world. And so when you see it, you start to see how it's true. If you would just don't lock your door and not say hi, say hi, introduce yourself. You as an Arab woman, you know, say hi to the neighbor, because that's what our religion teaches. So there's that Arab religion thing again. Our religion always, we even have a belief that you need to be nice to the seven, like all the way to leading down to your seventh neighbor. Like you have to introduce yourself. And so it makes a reference to the seventh neighbor. So that's all these neighbors. You have to be pleasant to them. You have to say hello. Welcome them in. Don't wait for them to welcome you. Be open. And so once you start putting yourself out there, these people who are different from you start accepting you. How can we accept? How can we expect to be accepted when we are not putting ourselves out there? You can wait at home all day. No one's going to come knock at your door. You have to put yourself out there. And so that's what I'm modeling for my kids. So if I'm doing one thing right, hopefully, it's showing my kids that be confident, be happy with who you are, meet people, get to know them, get to know their culture, and share yours. And I do that a lot anywhere I go. I student taught at Austin, and they embraced who I was. And they asked me, they were so awesome. They asked me to come up with just a list of what do we need to know about people like y'all? And I said, they were blunt. And I said, let me tell you the number one thing people do that's pretty intimidating, handshakes. Educate. We're not allowed to shake hands with the opposite gender. So that's religious because it's a form of touch. And so when, as a teacher, that's my only, so you think like it's the hijab, it's more the handshake. A parent extends their hand and I extend my hand back out, because you're facing this dilemma, and in a split second, you have to make the decision, do I explain that I can't shake their hand? Am I going to cause harm to this relationship? Are we there yet to establish that sense of, you know, like boundary? Or should I just go ahead and shake the hand and build this relationship? So there are times where I shake their hand, like a dad that's coming to meet me or an uncle that's coming, I'll shake their hand. And there are times where I feel comfortable enough to say, I am so sorry, with all due respect, I'm actually not allowed to shake your hand just because of a religious belief. But I told my Austin family that back then, and I said, don't extend your hand, please, because it's hard for us. Every Muslim faces this, male or female. Mm-hmm. We are not allowed to shake hands with the opposite sex, and sometimes it just happens so quickly that you do, and then there are other times where you can organize it. And so things like that, when they're willing to get to know you because you're willing to be open, we can fix that repair and we can fix the harm. You don't know that you've harmed unless you were told. So
there's one good thing that came from COVID.
Hey, that's what I told everyone. I'm like, oh my gosh, nobody extends their hand anymore. So yes, absolutely. And I do my due diligence of educating almost everybody around me about the handshaking, because they'll face a Muslim eventually, and now they know. And so I just go even at graduation, I organized it with the dean and let him know that I can't shake your hand when I cross the stage. And some girls did, not criticizing them at all, because he was a male. And some girls did what I did, and they just did this thing. And so the other girls who did probably shake hands went, I could have done that. But it's okay. It's not the end of the world. Our religion is very forgiving, and it's not like you have sinned. It's just, when possible, educate, be open, get others to know who you are, how you believe, so that they can accept you.
I love that. That's great. And you have educated me today.
Oh, thank you.
Just, I really appreciate that. And I think that being open is just so critical.
Absolutely.
Openness is actually a really true and intellectual skill. People
I love
don't even
seeing
think that.
That
it is, but it really is. It allows you to be very creative. It allows you to think differently. It allows you to be considering of other factors, of other ideas.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
So it really promotes growth. So openness also promotes lots of growth. So.
Well, Dr. Gully is famous for being a learner.
Yes,
and
I am.
Also a teacher, which brings us to Lessons with LaDonna.
Yes.
Every week we try to tap into her expertise. She's got a doctorate's degree in educational leadership. What do we have this week?
So this week we're going to talk a lot about what happens when we are faced with a with racism. What happens when we're faced, when we come face to face with maybe a racist remark, or someone may have said something and we've caught it on the back end, or like, oh wow, you know, what do I do, right? Or we're in a situation where we're in a room or having a dinner with a group of friends and there's a comment made, right?
Yes.
And so oftentimes immediately we want to maybe respond, right? But we don't really know how. So I would tell anyone, the first thing you want to do is you want to remain calm, because I will tell you that typically what happens when someone says something you don't like, right? We immediately either turn off or we become angry. Yeah. And so in this instance, you just really want to stay calm and you want to start questioning, you know, hey, why would you think that? Or I heard what you said earlier. What did you mean by that? I think that when you start to question people, it really helps them kind of assert, okay, so why did I say that? Some people will often say, did I say that? Right?
Yes.
Because they're really stunned at some that, you know, yeah, someone's actually pointing out something that I said. The other part of that is that you really want to help that person understand a different point of view at that time. You know, it's not to really tell them you're wrong, but it's saying, you know, have you ever thought about, or have you ever considered? And I think that when you start it that way, people really can accept what you're saying and be very open.
Yes.
To your response. But the other part of that is really showing empathy. And empathy is, once again, it's on that framework for educational equity, that we are really empathizing with that person who may not know, who may have not understood that that was a harm committed.
Absolutely.
At that moment. You know, and then it really is important that we point people in the right direction, or we ask them to consider, you know, or, you know, I would, maybe we should talk more about this, or would you like to look into this a little bit more with me? You know, so it gives us the opportunity to learn together. I think that that's really important. But we have to talk. We have to have lots of discussions and discourse. We have to be willing to sit down and have some space time to think and consider, you know, the possibilities. You know, and we have to want to be better and be,
yes,
different, because at the end of the day, after this is all said and done, it truly is about being human. It's about me honoring dignity. And how do I honor dignity? Dignity is not something that I have to earn. I get it because I'm human. And as one human to another, I deserve dignity. And so,
well, I want to ask you, from my point of view as a white guy,
mm-hmm,
I think some of this training you're talking about, when you are faced with a racist comment of some kind, how do you respond to it? Well, if I'm in a room full of white people, how do I train myself to respond the way I should?
I would say start by questioning.
Because you also said a lot of times they don't mean harm. A lot of times they do.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Well, and you know what? I mean, let's be honest. You're right. I have to say that, you know, I've been in situations where people said things with me. And so I'm glad that you've actually pointed that out, because I think that as a person of, as a black woman, I think that people are never going to say certain things around me that they will say in a company of maybe a group of people who look exactly like them, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I think it is those moments. There are those moments where people, I don't care who you are, you're going to have to accept responsibility for the entire room. And that means that you have to also say something about it. You cannot stand in it and allow it to continue. I think that it takes a high level of bravery, to be honest with you, because we all make assumptions, right? Oh, well, you're just like me. You look like, mm-hmm, me, right? We're looking for that. And so to say, you know what? I am like you. But at the same time, I really want you to understand that that is not appropriate. And let me share with you why.
And that goes back to the book I've brought up a couple of times, The Person You Mean to Be by Dolly,
yes,
Chugg, where you're not necessarily talking to that person who made a hateful comment. You're talking to the middle group, that group of people that is not brave enough to stand up and say something about it, but will listen to you and learn from it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's still useful, even if you're not going to change that one person's mind.
Yeah, because you're not going to change everyone's minds. We know that, right? But our hope is that people will begin to listen and begin to consider and begin to think and say, you know, I did not know that. I did not understand that. I had a conversation with someone literally yesterday, and I was mentioning something that I'm very aware of because of just my background and my experience. But they had never heard that before, and they were really stunned. And but they were so open to learning and saying, you know, I really want to learn more about that. That I did not know. I've made a misstep. I want to learn more. And so it's always an opportunity. Use every conversation as an opportunity to educate. I really believe that. And also challenge people, challenge their thinking. I think that when we do that and we're able to have conversations, now we're able to kind of push the window and say, hey, you know what? I do want to get to know you. I love what she said that, you know, in the Muslim religion, you must know all your neighbors. How many of us know all of our neighbors on our block? If I had to go seven houses down.
Right.
Right.
Gets you to wonder.
Exactly. It starts getting you to just think about like, oh, wow. You know, I don't know all of mine. That's my challenge. So thank you so much.
My wife would tell you I know all of ours.
Well, I believe that too.
Well, thank you, Aziza, for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
It was great.
Thank you.
Really informative. That's Aziza Basha, the teacher over at Cannaday Elementary. Send us an email if you want to join the discussion at letstalk@mesquiteisd.org or reach out to us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram by using the search term LetMISD. For Dr. LaDonna Gulley, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.